Hello. Thank you for the introduction, IK, and thank you to everyone for being here. Today, I'm going to be talking about a new definitional framework called public seed pseudorandom permutations, and this is joint work with Stefano Tassaro at UCSB. The traditional approach to build cryptographic schemes, more so in symmetric cryptography, is to base them on generic building blocks. These blocks are block ciphers like AES or hash functions like SHA-3. And this paradigm has been very successful in practice, and hence applied cryptographers recently have started asking the following question. Does there exist a simple building block that suffices for all symmetric cryptography? And the recent trend has been to use a seedless permutation as the basic building block. To cite a few examples, there are constructions of hash functions like Ketchak, a variant of which is the SHA-3 standard, of authenticated encryption schemes, of PRFs, of compression functions that use this permutation pi as its core primitive. Why? This permutation pi is nothing but an efficiently computable, efficiently invertible one-to-one function. These permutations in recent times have seen a lot of applications, and prominent cryptographers like Juan Damon have even gone on to call them as the Swiss Army knives of cryptography. These permutations arise in practice in one of two forms. One is via ad hoc constructions, which are designed to withstand cryptanalysis. This is the approach taken in constructions like Ketchak, Norex. Another one is to use an existing block cipher, like AES, and fix its key to, say, zero. This approach has been used to construct faster hash functions, even fast garbling schemes. So permutations are great in practice, but what about their theoretical foundations? In theory, for a permutation-based construction C, we ideally want to prove a theorem like this, that if pi satisfies some security notion X, then C of pi satisfies some security notion Y. So the question is, what is the notion X that suffices to prove something non-trivial, like collision resistance, for a permutation-based constructions like Ketchak? Sadly, there are no known standard model proofs for permutation-based constructions. The only known approach is hence to use the random permutation model, where pi is modeled as a random permutation, and the adversary is given only oracle access to both pi and pi inverse. However, random permutations are ideal objects, and they cannot even be instantiated. Moreover, random permutation model proofs only give security against generic attacks, where we hope that the adversary is not going to exploit implementation-specific vulnerabilities. And this case is in stark contrast to that of hash functions, where even though the random oracle model is popular, we have a sound understanding of what standard model assumptions or properties good hash functions can satisfy. When we come to permutations, we do not know of any such properties. So the question, therefore, is, what kind of hardness can you expect from a permutation? Note that we cannot expect one-wayness, compression, or even pseudo-randomness from a permutation. So in this work, we propose the first plausible standard model security assumption that you can make on permutations and show that this assumption is useful. More concretely, we give a new definitional framework called public seed pseudorandom permutations, or PSPRPs for short. In addition, we address two fundamental questions that any new framework like ours should address. First, can we have PSPRPs at all? And second, are they even useful? Note that our definitions are just a conceptual contribution, and they can be easily adapted from the UCE framework for seeded hash functions. However, proving that the notion of PSPRP makes sense and it's useful is what we show in this work, which is where our main technical contributions lie. So before moving forward, I want to give you a teaser of how we resolve these two fundamental questions. So we show in the paper that PSPRP implies a lot of applications. We recover a few of these applications by constructing UCE hash functions, which are known to imply them from previous work. In particular, we construct UCEs via existing practical constructions like sponges. We also investigate what applications can be directly instantiated from PSPRPs. And for that, we study efficient garbling from fixed key block ciphers. And UCEs via the Feistel construction also imply PSPRPs, giving some validity of the existence of them, of PSPRPs. Okay, so the plan of my talk is to give the PSPRP notion first, then give constructions of PSPRPs and discuss a few of its applications, and finally I'll conclude with a few, in fact, many open questions. Okay. So the first observation is as same as in the complexity theoretic analysis of hash functions, which is that we need to extend any primitive to have a seed to define non-trivial security notions. So now, our basic object is going to be that P, which is a tuple of three algorithms, gen, pi, and pi inverse. All of them are efficient, such that gen takes in a security parameter and outputs a seed. Pi is the forward evaluation algorithm that takes in an input x and a seed s and outputs y. Pi inverse is the backward evaluation algorithm. And I'm going to just assume pi with the seed s as pi s throughout this talk. So when the seed is kept secret, the traditional security notion that we all know of is that of a pseudo-random permutation, where an efficient distinguisher cannot distinguish if it's been given access to a permutation p under a seed s or to a random permutation and its inverse. Right? But here the seed is kept secret. If you give the seed to the distinguisher, the notion of PRP completely breaks down. So, informally, the way we define security in the public seed case, which is what we care about, is we tear the distinguisher into two stages. The first stage adversary still plays the PRP game, that is, with Oracle access to one of these oracles, and the seed is kept secret. And the second stage adversary learns the seed, but has no Oracle access. And we allow some information flow between these two stages. This paradigm for defining security was first seen in UCE framework for seeded hash functions. So UCE is a two-stage security notion for hash functions, where the first-stage adversary, called the source, is given access to a hash function or to a truly random function. Source makes multiple queries to its oracle and outputs a leakage to the second-stage adversary, which we are going to call a distinguisher, which in addition, as promised, is going to learn the seed S and output a bit P. And UCE expects that these two worlds be indistinguishable. To define the PSPRP security, we are going to adopt the same paradigm, except that now source is going to get access to a permutation, a seeded permutation, and hence we need to take care of both forward and backward queries. Respectively, in the other world, it's going to get access to a random permutation row and its inverse. The second stage proceeds as before. D gets the leakage, and the seed outputs a bit P. Okay. We say that P is PSPRP secure if for all efficient sources and distinguishers, these two worlds are indistinguishable. Unfortunately, we cannot have security against all sources and distinguishers, because there exists this source that makes a forward query on 0 to the n, a fixed input, to its oracle, gets the response y, sets its as is leakage, and now distinguisher getting this leakage seed is going to output 1 if and only if y is the image of 0 to the n under pi s. So in the left case, it's always going to output 1. In the right case, y, because of this row, is going to be a uniformly random string independent of the seed. So it's going to output 1 with probability at most 1 by 2 to the n. Therefore, S and D can distinguish these two worlds, and we cannot have PSPRP security against all sources. So to define non-trivial security notions, we need to restrict sources. So now we say PSPRP is PSPRP calligraphic S secure if for all sources in this class calligraphic S and all distinguishers, these two worlds are indistinguishable. Okay, so that's our definition. In particular, in this work, we are going to introduce two new source classes, two source classes, which are adopted from the UCE framework, one of unpredictable sources, one of research secure sources. And both of these restrictions capture in some way that the distinguisher cannot predict the queries by the source, which is what, in the previous case, led to the attack, because distinguisher knew that source was querying on 0 to the n. Moreover, the set of unpredictable sources, as you can see, is a subset of reset secure sources, and hence, PSPRP for reset sources is the stronger assumption. Okay? So let me define unpredictability first. A source having access to a random permutation rho and its inverse is said to be unpredictable if a predictor A, given the leakage from the source and access to rho and rho inverse, cannot predict any queries by the source or its inverse, okay? Which is what is captured by this game. Moreover, if A is computationally unbounded or computationally bounded, we'll give you two different notions, statistical unpredictability, computational unpredictability, where statistical unpredictability is clearly the stronger restriction. Moreover, we can show that a technique by Bruska, Farshim, and Mittelbach that the computational notion of PSPRP security does not make sense if I/O exists. So for the rest of this talk, I'm only going to focus on PSPRP security for statistically unpredictable sources. Next, reset security. It's a two-stage, it's an indistinguishability-based notion where in the first world, source and the reset adversary, they are interacting with the same random permutation rho and rho inverse. And in the other case, source and reset adversary are interacting with independent random permutations, rho and rho 1. And we say that S is reset secure if these two worlds are indistinguishable in the eyes of R. And as before, there are going to be two notions, when R is bounded and unbounded. And since computationally unpredictable sources are a subset of computationally reset secure sources, the computational notion does not make sense. And hence, for the rest of this talk, I'm going to focus on PSPRP security for statistically reset sources. Okay? So just for recap, if I have lost you on the way, we have defined two new assumptions and permutations called PSPRP for reset sources and PSPRP for unpredictable sources. These are, in fact, where reset security is the stronger notion or stronger assumption. These are, in fact, mirror images of the UCE notions for reset secure sources and unpredictable sources. And these UCE notions have played a central role in the UCE theory, and a lot of applications have followed from them. So a natural question is, can these two also play a central role? And in fact, they do, and that is what we are going to show next. So construction and applications. So we come back to the two fundamental questions that I was talking about. We've defined PSPRP security. Can we have them, and are they even useful? To address the first question, we are going to give constructions of PSPRPs from UCEs, and also we are going to give heuristic constructions which we validate in ideal models. To answer the second question, we are going to construct UCEs which will allow us to recover all applications of the UCE framework now from PSPRPs. And as a direct application, we're going to study gobbling from fixed key block ciphers. Okay? And in particular, I'm going to start with these two, because this reduction between PSPRPs and UCEs have a common technical denominator, which is a new restricted notion of indifferentiability called CP sequential indifferentiability. So indifferentiability in the traditional sense, for the special case, considers a construction C that uses a random permutation RP as its primitive. And we want this C to behave like a random oracle. And we want this in a setting where the adversary can make queries to the construction as well as to the primitive. However, this does not make sense because there is no primitive on the right-hand side. So indifferentiability asks that there exists a simulator that makes these two worlds indistinguishable. So this is the traditional notion. We restrict the notion even further by asking the adversary to make all its construction queries first and then move on to primitive queries. And this notion we define as CP sequential indifferentiability. We say that a construction C is CP sequentially indifferentiable from a random oracle if these two worlds are indistinguishable. And clearly, full indifferentiability implies CP sequential indifferentiability. And if you consider the reverse ordering, where you allow the adversary to query the primitive first and then ask A1 to query the construction later, that notion is called sequential indifferentiability, which is incomparable to our work. Okay? All right. So now let's address the question of how do you construct UCEs from PSPRPs? Okay? Via this new notion that we have defined. So if you are given a construction C that uses a random permutation, which is sequentially indifferentiable from a random oracle, if you instantiate this permutation with a PSPRP, what you get is this construction CP, which is UCE reset secure. This is what we prove. Okay? Similar result was proved by the UCE authors in the follow-up paper, but they required full indifferentiability for this to go through, and they stated it only for UCE domain extension. As an immediate corollary of our work, every permutation-based indifferentiable hash function now would be a good way to transform PSPRP into a UCE. And one such construction is the sponge construction, which is the basis of the SHA-3 standard, and a result by Bertoni et al. Already establishes the indifferentiability of this construction, and hence, as a corollary, you get that sponge is CP sequentially indifferentiable from a random oracle, and hence, if you instantiate this row with a PSPRP, you get that sponge is now a UCE. And this is great, because this validates the entire sponge paradigm for UCE applications. But since we are relying on CP sequential indifferentiability, we ask if simpler constructions exist, and we show that, indeed, there is this construction called CHOP, which takes in an n-bit input, passes through the permutation row, and outputs an r-bit output. We show that this construction is CP sequentially indifferentiable from a random function, and however, this is not completely indifferentiable. If you instantiate row with pi s now, which is a PSPRP, what you get is CHOP is a UCE for reset sources. However, there is more to this construction. This construction has a special property, as we show in the paper, that allows us to get UCE for unpredictable sources from PSPRP from unpredictable sources, which is the weaker assumption. However, we are getting something weaker in terms of UCEs, but that also suffices for a lot of applications, as shown by BHK. So, and CHOP is a fixed input length function. To get a variable input length UCE, you can use domain extension techniques from previous works. All right. So now, the second question, which is constructing UCEs from PSPRPs, a similar reduction follows. If you are given a random oracle-based construction C, which is CP sequentially indifferentiable from a random permutation, if you instantiate this random oracle by a UCE for reset sources, what you get is a PSPRP for reset sources. Okay? And an immediate corollary is that if you have a hash function-based indifferentiable permutation, it's a good way to transform a UCE into a PSPRP. And one such construction is that of Feistel. There is a long-standing work on Feistel which establishes the full indifferentiability. The state of the art, we know that 8 rounds suffices for full indifferentiability. So 8 rounds suffices to transform a UCE into a PSPRP. Therefore, PSPRP now exists in the standard model if UCEs do, which is great. But since we are relying only on CP sequential indifferentiability for this transformation, we ask if a round number lower than 8 suffices. And we show in this work that 5 is indeed sufficient because CP sequential indifferentiability can be achieved at 5 rounds already. So if you have a UCE for reset sources, passes through a 5-round Feistel, what you get is a PSPRP for reset sources. Our 5-round proof is the most technically involved result of the paper. However, I'm not going to go into the details because I think I'm running out of time. So our simulator also relies on chain completion techniques from previous works, and it heavily exploits the query ordering in the sense that adversary does not query the construction after making its primitive queries, and we have to, in the process, introduce new chain completion techniques to get away with the low round number. And there is this open question, is that if do 4 rounds, suffice for transforming a UCE into a PSPRP. Okay? We showed PSPRPs can go through Feistel, but that's not how you would want to come up with instantiation in practice. In practice, you may want to work with a block cipher, and a natural way to get a PSPRP from a block cipher is to use the key of the block cipher as the seed. We show that this is a good way to get a PSPRP in the idle cipher model. Another primitive is to start with the Ketchak permutation. These permutations are very efficient in practice, but they don't have a seed. So we say that if you extend these permutations to have a seed via the even Mansour construction, then that's a good way to get a PSPRP, and we validate this in random permutation model. Okay? Note that we are validating everything in ideal models because we do not have standard model assumptions on block ciphers and permutations. As a direct application, we study application of gobbling, which is known to have applications as far as multi-party computation. We study fast gobbling from BHKR, and which only makes fixed key which only makes calls to fixed key block ciphers and hence is very fast, but they have a proven random permutation model. We show that if you replace that the fixed key block cipher with a PSPRP for a random seed, what you get is secure garbling in the standard model. So we put that proof in random permutation model to standard model. So this shows that PSPRPs are useful beyond just recovering applications of the UC framework. Okay, so finally concluding, we introduced the notion of PSPRPs, which is the framework that introduces the first standard model assumption on permutations. We discussed construction of PSPRPs and its applications. There are a few open questions in this area. One is that, can PSPRPs enable other applications like PRNGs, authenticated encryption? Another one is to resolve the round complexity of 5 still for PSPRPs. We show that 5 is sufficient. We don't know if 4 works. Public seed pseudorandomness is a general paradigm which allows us to give PSPRPs and UCEs as special cases, which this is the paradigm that we define in the paper. And as a special case, one can consider now a public seed ideal cipher, but we do not know if it has any applications. And finally, we realize that PSPRPs are a strong notion. So simpler assumptions on permutations that maybe allows you to prove collision resistance of the SHA-3 hash function is another open question. Thank you.
Okay, any question or comment? Okay, that ends. No, there is one question in the back.
So should we call UCEs public seed PRFs now?
So they are public seed hash functions, yes. They are public seed PRFs, exactly. So you're already getting familiar with that notion. Thank you.